And now it is already time for our first speaker. So our first speaker has made it her personal mission to get women on top. During her impressive career, she has been passionate about making radical change in the private sector with regards to diversity, gender equality, and inclusion. In 2010, she received the Women to Watch Award by Business Insurance in the USA, and currently she operates as chair board of Aon Holdings. Her motto remains the power of diversity on top. Please give a warm welcome to Margriet Soeteman-Reyne.
Thank you, Mies and Pien. It's a pleasure to be with you guys. It's really funny because after you actually are on the stage, it's always a challenge to step in the footsteps of those young generations who have grown up with presenting very naturally. So you guys have learned it already here at UWC, how to present, how to engage with audience. A thing lots of our elder women can still learn from. So thank you for doing that introduction. For me, the challenge to talk to you guys today about diversity, about female leadership. And maybe to first start with what leadership is about, because it's very easy to start talking about female leadership. But maybe first, in order for you to understand what I think a leader is the following. I think it's not upon yourself to call yourself a leader. I think it's upon others to call you a leader. So you're only a leader, in my definition, when other people would like to follow you. And in order to be followed, you need to be inspirational, you need to be motivational, you need to actually take people on a journey and have a common purpose, which makes sense, not only for yourself, but for the bigger good. A saying which is for me really very important in my life is in Dutch, and now I need somebody to translate in English because I never know how to do this, is wie goed doet, goed ontmoet. Anyone wants to take up the challenge to translate that in English? Yeah, be the change you want to see. But it's also about meeting. It definitely is implicable in that, but it's also that if you do good, you will meet good people as well. And for me, being here today at UWC Maastricht, it's really inspiring, and you've maybe already sensed a little bit, but this school has multinationalities. If you talk about globalization of the world, you can see it here. And you not can only see it here, you can sense it here. There are people from different cultures, different backgrounds, different geographies who are willing to listen to each other, who are not judgmental. They first are willing to listen to your part of the story. Why are you different? What's the similarity? And all of that in a mix is making this school a fantastic school. And if we then talk about diversity and leadership, we all see that there is a big journey going on since the past year, which is especially it started in the US with Black Lives Matter. But of course, we've been struggling for years to get a better understanding of what it is to be to have an equal society. And for those of you who are from the Netherlands in this audience, I'm just trying to get some out. Oh, the majority is okay. So we always in the Netherlands talk about emancipatie. And if you take a look at emancipatie, we can actually see we have three waves. And the first wave was started by Aletta Jacobs. So for the youngsters amongst yourselves, she was really the trailblazer who started and tried to get women more prominently visible, but also ensure that we got voting rights. This was in 1990, so more than 100 years ago. Then in the 1970s, and I was just born, I'm a 1966 born, but in the 1970s we had the Dolomina's in Amsterdam. And those ladies were really fighting for their own rights. We know now that in Texas still abortion is being discussed. Those ladies went up the barricades in Amsterdam and protested because they wanted actually access to their own belly. They wanted to make sure they could make any decision relating to their health and to their future themselves. And they succeeded. Then in the Netherlands a few years ago we had another movement, and that's what we call the third wave, and that's been actually created by the fact that we at some moment we saw that in society, while we are 50% of the population in the Netherlands and around the globe, we saw that although we're 50%, we don't get an equal treatment. Somehow, when you take a look at the private sectors, at the large companies, we see that women are not as well represented in the top and the boards of the companies than in the other regions. And so what happened was that we were thinking like, why is this happening? What's going on? And some of the factors which actually we looked at was that, you know, people said they're not visible. Our current prime minister actually dared to say, I'm still appalled, he dared to say And he did say that we can't find them. You know, this is a room full of women. For sure there will be someone here who is eligible to be a minister. We have one here in the past, so there must be more here. And so we thought we can engage in a fight with him, but fighting doesn't help. So we actually went and looked what's happening in the world, what's going on, and we saw a number of things. So if you take a look at the business case for diversity and equality, the first thing you see is that a number of companies, McKinsey, Goldman Sachs, have all written very good reports about why it should be there. And they've written reports which underscore that companies with a more diverse board are more profitable, more sustainable, more innovative. Now, I can go on. And fact. Yeah, so we can discuss facts, we can argue facts, but these are really facts, they've been stated. And there's always another argument about something else, so let's not argue, but it is now really the case that companies with more women on board have a broader diverse perspective and have more diversity of thought and opinion. Then we have the social case. We already said, you know, 50% of the population is female. In the Netherlands, 54% of the graduates of universities and higher education schools are women. So, why are we not there at the top? And then we said, yeah, but in your time, Marguerite, when you studied, when we, lots of you here are present, Marjolein, when we studied, you know, there were more men than women. Not a fact. So if you go to the Centraal Bureau for the Statistiek or the Centraal Planbureau, Cultureel Planbureau, you can see that those numbers are not even right. But somehow, in the Netherlands, and I'm not going into the discussion of part-time working or why we're not as productive as other countries, but we lag behind. Then if we take a look at the argument which has come up the past year, which is a more and more becoming legal and a moral argument. The legal argument being like, you know, we're part of society, we should be get equal treatment. All of us know that in the Dutch constitution there is equal treatment, equal opportunities. And somehow that's not being followed up as it should be, which is actually quite interesting, because we did argue the past year during COVID around why the church was separate from the state.
Yeah, we gaan het zo doen. Oké. Is this better? Yeah. Okay, perfect. So we discussed this year the difference between state and church. But when we talk about the article equal opportunity, equal treatment, then suddenly that's not serious enough, or we shouldn't act. I think it's important. And so what has happened is that with the initiative SER Topvrouwen, and it used to be called Topvrouwen.nl, we were looking for people, the women around the globe, the women in the Netherlands, the Dutch women around the globe, there are also lots of them internationally, who have a career, who are the role models, and who we could make visible. And very quickly we discovered that there were more than 2,000 very eligible women. In the meantime, we have 3,000, I think there are 10,000 even more, who are board ready, who have the right qualifications, who did go to university, and blah, 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 and so on. So the argument, they're not there, we don't know them, that's no longer an argument. But then to get a little bit into the situation, why did we not reach it before? What happened? And there are definitely reasons from outside we can blame, but we should also take an inside outlook, not only the outside in look, but also the inside outlook. Because women lack confidence. Men have an oversupply of confidence, Lodewijk. So really, I'm looking at all the guys upstairs. This is really, I won't quote any Harvard Business Studies, because there's some very interesting professors, Thomas Camoro, who talks about this particular thing. And then men have confidence, overconfidence, and they think they're better. And this is funny, because statistically, they can't even be better. Statistically, it's not even possible. So this is always the argument if people say, like, yeah, diversity on board. Statistically, it's impossible that more men than women are better. But anyhow, so let them believe their story. That's maybe their fairy tale for their... we have Cinderella, they have this story. So what happened was that SER Topvrouwen became pretty active. We engaged with all, not only with the women, but also, of course, with the men. Because this is not a journey we need to do on our own. It's about together. And that's maybe the most important argument today. It's together. You don't do this alone, because otherwise you antagonize each other. This is about a dialogue. It's not about a monologue. And I think what's been the most interesting journey for me is that if you engage in this dialogue and start looking at facts, we discovered a survey done by Volkman and Zenger, and Volkman and Zenger are two professors in the US, and they identified 90 leadership capabilities. And then they went into more than 10,360 assessments. 360 assessment is an assessment where everybody around you is giving feedback around your performance. So if you're a CEO of a company, then your clients give feedback, your board members give feedback, your supervisor board give feedback. And of those more than 10,000 assessments, they discovered that of those 19 leadership capabilities, that out of the 19, women outperform men in 17. Ah, fact, really nice. So 17 out of 19. So then we argue, and then we take a look, what are those two where women were only a little bit behind, but we were behind. And those two were strategy and STEM. And STEM, of course, being science, technology, engineering, and math. Now, if you take a look what the current vision and what's going on around the globe on this topic, we recently had the G20 coming together for the first time in Italy on women empowerment. So everybody familiar, I'm looking at the kids upstairs. G20, do you know what the G20 is? Yeah? Nodding? If you don't know it, you can say it. What is the G20? Okay, now the G20 is the group of 20, are the 20 most, I would call them important countries around the globe. And their leaders come together every year to discuss what's the status of what's going on. And for the first time this year, Mario Draghi is this year the chair, identified that women empowerment was a topic he wanted a specific meeting about. And Mario Draghi had two important things. As we all know, in Europe, you know, Italy has been very badly hit by the COVID, by the economic crisis. And he has made up a recovery plan, and that recovery plan consists of 191.5 billion support he's been given by the European Commission. But out of that, a lot is for digital transformation, all the things we need in order to get better operational in Italy as well. But 7 billion he is actually dedicated to equality in Italy. And he did this in the following format. He said, if you take a look what the importance is also from an economic perspective, to increase labor participation, and that's in Italy only 53% of the women work, to the average in Europe, which is 67%. If we increase the 53 to 67, it will add an additional 7% to its gross national product. That's immense. In the Netherlands also, McKinsey has calculated if we use, if we increase the participation of women, that it actually adds 114 billion euro at a minimum to our gross national product. So economically, it's you know, there is no, it's there, we should do it. So it's all clear. Now, last but not least, I'm going to take a look at Charlotte. You're going to tell me how much minutes I have, huh? Okay, perfect. So what's more important, back to confidence, and this is not a historical anecdote, but I like the anecdote nevertheless, so I'm going to tell it, is that we women have confidence. But we need to help each other a little bit to help each other to be confident. And the anecdote I want to refer to is one where Winston Churchill was walking on the street with his wife. His wife was called Clementine. And suddenly Clementine starts talking to a garbage man. And after a few minutes, she comes back to her husband. And Winston Churchill, the former Prime Minister of England, of course, says like, hey, Clementine, who was that? And she says like, yeah, that's the garbage man, yeah, I know. Yeah, but why are you talking to him? Yeah, we used to have something going on years ago. So he says like, so Clementine, you're fortunate that you married me. Wow, otherwise you would have been the wife of a garbage man. I said, no, Winston, you're fortunate you married me. Otherwise he would have been next Prime Minister of the United Kingdom. Yeah, so for me, this little one, and it's not historical because this is arguable, but it's about confidence is in you. And every time I talk to anyone, I say, believe in yourself. So we can do a lot of economics, studies in society, and you name it. But the first and foremost, and that's why it's so important to have education like this, the UWC, to create a world of people who believe in themselves. To believe yourself is the most important virtue you can have. And if you don't believe in yourself, why would anyone else believe in you? And in order to make a change in this world, it's really important to create a society of people who believe in themselves, who are capable of learning, of being more curious, And also have the trust and the confidence that they're able to do something with other people helping them out. And so I really invite you all today, and this is my most important ask to all, you know, believe in the kids over here, believe in the kids who are to come. They are the builders of a society. They're looking for a more sustainable world. And let's make sure that they can stand on our shoulders. I always love, you know, when we talk about Aletta Jacobs and the Dolominas, I'm standing every day when I work and, you know, do what I do, I'm standing on their shoulders. But we, with this generation, we can ensure that some other kids, other ladies from Africa and the Middle East, Northern, that they can stand on our shoulders. And you can only do it by a simple thing. I'm going to do this anyhow now, because this is, you know, who knows what a QR code is nowadays? Who doesn't know what a QR code is? So everybody does, and that's a good thing of giving. And so I'll do this already, Mean and Peace, because Mean and Peace. So there's a QR code at the back, and we're going to ask every one of you to check that out. You know, you can give already today, tomorrow. And last but not least, and that's maybe the biggest call I want to ask. So doing things like this is fabulous. But what's really interesting is also to take a look when you leave today, you've seen the school and you've seen the kids, you've sensed how they are, you know, so inspirational. Then take a look what you can do in your own home organization at home, because some of you, you know, I live in The Hague. Like, organize something where you can do something together, you know, motivate other people to do the same, to have other people to ensure that other kids are able to stand on their shoulders too. And it doesn't need to be big. All small pieces make a big collective. So thank you so much. Questions? Yeah, and now I know.
Thank you very much. And I think it's wonderful how you're saying that we don't have to fight, but we have to build bridges together. And that's really where we are here for. And I think that the audience does have some questions. Is there someone with a question who first wants to call their name and then ask a question to Ms. Margaret? Well, I will start off with a question, because I do have a question. Because you were talking about confidence, and I think that's something that's really important, and that's also maybe what I'm feeling that's sometimes lacking. But what about you? How did you get that confidence, how you're able to do the things you're doing? Where did you get this confidence from?
So I think that I remember my first performance review, so I started working. When I started working, I never thought that there would be anything be unequal. That's important to mention today, because a lot of people say, yeah, your generation don't think about it's all equal equality. You don't experience inequality until a later stage. So when I started working, my first performance review, I still remember the guy sitting there like, what? So what do you want to achieve? I said, the top. The top? Yeah, the top. And to be honest, this is the fun part. I still don't know what the top is. I married a pilot, so the sky is unlimited for me in the meantime. But I've noticed, for me, this is a very for me, it's important to say, like, I've noticed that my house is a house because it's a roof above my head. And I've noticed that's, for me, the value of a house. And so back to the top, and why I'm saying this, because if you move to another house, the value of the house doesn't change. It's a roof on your top to feel safe and guarded. So I've learned to accept that, you know, back to my own, the top of that, I think it's about being better. And maybe not being bigger.
Yeah. Wonderful.
Yeah.
And I think also daring to speak up and say that that's what your goal is. Because it's not everyone who wants to, who is able to say, I want to reach the top during their first survey.
Yeah. So he's still, so the, those, one of them has passed away of my former boss. The other one still is alive and he still is like, yeah, she said she wanted to reach the top. But you have to imagine one thing, the top can be, it can be something which is visible, but it can also be something which is invisible. Yeah. And why do I state this? You guys are at the school and you've graduated here. And it's very important that you take a look, you know, also what's your mental well-being. It's not only about physical things or monetary things. It's about how you are as a person. If you want to become a writer, the top can be that you write a very nice book or a novel.
Yeah.
So that's why I think that you should be very careful, because in my life, in my business, it's all about business. And I'm not sure, you know, I think that there have been very people who reached the top. And they're still mentioned in history books, while some of the businessmen of today won't be mentioned in the history books of tomorrow.
Yes, exactly. And we all have our own house with our own top. Thank you very much. Are there other questions from the audience? Well, you've left everyone. Oh, yes, there's.
I'll come to you with the mic. Could you first introduce yourself and then?
My name is Dasha. Pleasure to meet you all. Hi. So here we're talking about equality in the workplace and generally in life and in the world. And what about equality at home? Because of course, let's say now a lot of women work 40 hours a week or more, like possibly yourself, maybe, as well as men. But you know, all the house tasks, the kids, the laundry, the whatever. And we've seen that during COVID when all the schools closed even more. It's the women who leave jobs to take care of the kids and of the house. How? What's your opinion on that?
Yeah, so a very good question, by the way. It's not only about, so what we've seen that women were the most affected by the crisis the past year because they lost their jobs when you were, they were the caretakers. They took care of the families, took care of the parents. Also not to forget, and that's really an awful thing to mention, but also we've seen a terrible increase in domestic violence towards women in the past year, and not only in the Netherlands, but everywhere around the globe. You're going to talk about Afghanistan, we know what's going on there. So on different levels, you've seen, because of different circumstances, a world which has definitely changed, and some not always to the good. What's important to realize is that I don't know. I'm a very positive thinker. I feel that the next levels of generations are looking to do things together. My husband and I totally did our two family together. My daughter said in the interview with a famous Dutch journalist last year that my mom, my dad was more a mom to her than I was a mom. So, and we do everything really together. And I think that your generation is the same. But I do think that the Netherlands, though, is a very conservative culture country, and it's been created by also by fiscal reasons, etc., etc. The fact that we are one of the late last countries. I'm not going in all the law. We had last week a law approved, which is the quotum law, and it's a new diversity law in the Netherlands. We are one of the last in Europe to get that law approved, and then we still were arguing in the Senate. Because people were asking questions about, you know, the rechten van de mens, which were already all other countries. Italy has a law, Germany has a law, France has a law, Norway has a law. And then we were discussing the quotum law, and we are behind. And if you take a look what's happening on all of this, if we are back to even at home or in the office or wherever, if we don't ensure equality, we're going to lag more behind. And one last fact, Netherlands was listed second in 2018 on the Global Innovation Index, which is an index to measure innovation around the globe. Switzerland was one. And we actually moved downwards. We were degraded. We're now, only 3 years later, we're number six. So our innovation in our country is lagging behind because we are not looking at equality as we should it. So it's very important. That's one of the elements which innovates as well. But so it's important to have diversity of thought and opinion to make sure that the culture, not only measure it, but also the culture at home and in companies is changing, so people are enabled to do equal parenting, you know, to avoid gender pay gaps, etc. So I can go on for an hour. There are a number of things we should do, but it's an important topic, and it's about culture.
Thank you for your question, Dasha. And I think this is also where your speech came back about dialogue, and it's also about men and women together, that we both have to raise our voice and work together in this. Thank you. Are there other questions from the audience?
Yes.
Give you the mic.
Thank you. Costanza, you touched upon having quotum in terms of diversity. We were touching upon this at the beginning when we were discussing here with the other ladies I'm with. Do you think that's the solution, to pass a law and force a certain percentage of people, maybe of color or women, into a boardroom or into a company? Is that really the way to achieve equality, to force with, yeah, you know?
Thank you, Constanze. So I would prefer not, but given the fact we've not been able to achieve it in any other means, I've been a big yes. And I think the point you're raising also, it's not only about gender equality. So if you take a look what's going on in the United States, so the governor Newsom, and he was, thank God, he was re-elected in California. In California, they already had a gender equality law for boards, so they had already a quotum law for boards some years ago. And they changed it last year to also to minorities, so including LGBTQ and people from a different ethnical background, etc. And NASDAQ in the United States has recently also said we would like the 3,000 listed companies at NASDAQ, we would like to do the same. We would like to make sure that they are going to have diverse boards. Goldman Sachs last year, David Solomon said in during the World Economic Forum, I want to make sure that every company has a diverse board, and if it doesn't, I'm not going to help them to take them to the stock exchange to do an IPO. And the reason why is because with WeWorks, they saw that there were issues with non-diverse boards. They don't see certain risks. There are other stats, and this is back to sustainability. Boards with women have a better eye for environmental, social, and governance. Have a better eye for impact investing. And this is the awkward part to summarize. You know, we are talking about a business case all the time for diversity and inclusion. And if you talk about doing good for society, doing good for the public good, we should do it because it's better for all the things happening in life. So for me, this is not only about economics. It's because it should be, because it's morally something which should be the case. You know, why should anyone be less than someone else? We should all be equally treated. Okay.
Thank you very much. Let's build bridges. So let's build bridges, be confident, and speak up.